What's going on, you guys? Theo here with the big review, back yet again with another King of Fighters All-Star video. And in today's video, we are going to be revisiting our Spotlight series as we take a deep dive on Boss Syndrome Ignis across a plethora of PvE modes and check out his viability. But before we do all of that, make sure you guys smash that like button and subscribe. And if you haven't already heard, you still do have a few days left to get your names entered in for that drawing for that $25 Google Play or iOS gift card giveaway that we have going on. Link will be in the description with all the details, but without further ado, let's go ahead and get into this video. Now, starting out with the typing and the leadership skill, we have a blue balance type, and blue balance typing isn't necessarily the best nor the worst in the world. Really, it's just that it's kind of just there. There's really not a whole lot of things that you would find yourself needing a blue balance for, maybe in specific weeks of time attack, but that is going to be about it. But otherwise, it's going to be a fairly unimpressive typing overall. But really, with his typing, it doesn't really matter so much because he is a Boss Syndrome fighter, and therefore he's going to be able to slot in next to a lot of top leaders in the game, and he also is one of the top leaders in the game himself, so a lot of times he'll just be the leader, and you will just default to him. Now, speaking of his leadership skill, he is going to increase all star fighters' attack by 55% and decrease their HP by 5%. For those of you who have not heard, basically the all star fighter tag here is going to be one that you find on all of your Boss Syndrome fighters, all of your special signature fighters, and your collaboration fighters. So, being the fact that he can buff and lead all of those types of characters, it's going to make him be very, very versatile in a lot of things out there, such as Immortals or Guild Raid or so on and so forth. So, overall, with these two things, I would say his leadership skill and his tags pretty much make up for any downsides that his typing might leave him, and overall, a pretty darn good set right there. So, looking at the cores, let's go ahead and take a look here. We have a 30% power charge rate increase. You see this on quite a few of these limited banner characters, and it's definitely welcome on him. Definitely going to be one of those cores that you like to see starting out for anybody. Now, moving on here to his exclusives, he's going to have Ruler of Darkness. This is going to grant him Darkness Immunity, which is going to come in handy against Guild Raid Geese. And then also, he is going to decrease active skill cooldowns by 1 second upon landing a basic attack, guard included, with a 50% chance to increase all enemies' damage received by 35% for 7 seconds upon landing an active skill, guard included, on a cooldown of 12 seconds. So, for those of you who do not know what his gimmick is at this point, Ruler of Darkness is one of the most broken cores in the game, and the main reason for that is it is decreasing your active skill cooldowns every time you land a basic. So, you basically are going to have infinite skills on this character, and you can kind of go in and for this reason be able to just spam and not even really need to worry about using your awakening rotation with this character. It's kind of ridiculous, and even though his basic string does tend to be a little bit on the slow end, it really doesn't matter when every time you hit at least just one of those hits, you're basically shaving off 1 second from your cooldowns. It gets a little bit nutty, especially in Guild Raid, as you guys have seen in some of my solo videos, but it is something that is very easy to exploit. Now, finally, we have Merciless God Creation Plan, which I still say is the most edgelord core name in the entire game, but it is going to deal darkness damage equal to 30% of attack to the target upon landing an attack, guard included, with a 40% chance to apply fear to all enemies for 1 second upon landing an active skill, guard included, for 8 seconds cooldown. Now, with this here, basically you're going to be able to deal darkness damage every time you land an attack. This is not going to apply darkness. This is going to act much the same as what we have seen with Boss Syndrome Rugal, as well as Dancer Elizabeth in the past, so it is always nice to be able to deal that dot damage, kind of just get that 1 second burst damage on there, and that definitely helps kind of bump his damage up because his damage isn't all that impressive. Now, as far as this 40% chance to apply fear to all enemies for 1 second, this is really good. Fear is basically a CC. It's the newest CC we have in the game that was added in with Nightmare Geese, and it is going to basically be a stun. So, very nice that he has this here. Now, finally on the Boss Syndrome Volume 3 exclusive core, which he will share alongside Boss Syndrome Original Zero. He is going to gain 1.4% power every 0.4 seconds in guard stance, with a PvP exclusive of gaining super armor for 2 seconds when accumulated attack received, guard included, reaches 5 times on a cooldown of 20 seconds. So when it comes to these exclusive cores, they've brought back the ability to charge your own power whenever you're in guard. That is always something that is welcome. I definitely prefer that to taking away power, because I don't necessarily play a lot of PvP where you would prefer to see that, but with this, very good stuff. Now, the exclusive for PvP here that is going to be a save. Basically, whenever he gets comboed, he's going to save himself, or at least attempt to, a super armor for 2 seconds. You like to see these on your characters. It's always nice to have. So, overall, the cores are great. Let's go ahead and move on to the skills. So first up on the S1, we are going to increase penetration by 1600 for 7 seconds and deal shock damage equal to 28% of attack to the target every 1 second for 10 seconds upon landing a skill. So the increase to penetration is always nice. You always like to see that defense shred, and then you also get that shock damage as well. So you start to see the dots on this kit. Next up on the S2, we are going to have hyper armor, and we're also going to have a PvP exclusive of disabling the target's active skills for 4 seconds upon landing a skill or a guard, which is very, very devastating, and this is going to be an interrupt. So you have hyper armor as well as skill disable in PvP on a interrupt skill. This is going to be one of his best skills in general, in my opinion, and it's definitely one that you want to spam as much as possible, especially with that great core that is lowering your skill cooldowns. You can almost have hyper armor permanently with this character. It's pretty insane. Now, next up on the S3, we are going to increase attack by 36% for 7 seconds with a PvP exclusive to remove 10% power from the target upon landing a skill or a guard. So, pretty generic little S3 here. You're going to have this on a grab skill. However, this is a teleporting grab skill, which is pretty darn nice. We'll talk more about that when we get into the skill animations, but a pretty good, decent skill overall. Now, finally, on the finishers, on his core finisher, he is going to be able to apply shock damage, so you will get a dot on that finisher, which is always welcome and always a nice little boon to any account. And then if we take a look over here, we'll go ahead and take a look at the imprint stones. My recommendation with these for all of you guys out there who are trying to get these stones is just to go with the attack stones. That is going to be my recommendation there. If you really want to take a look even deeper and look at some of the previous Boss Syndrome stones, you can always do that. Although, I would say that the ones that are for the Volume 3 characters are going to suit you just fine, and you really don't have to worry too much about it. Now, when it comes to the equipments here, I will talk about the finisher card real brief here. So if we go ahead and take a look, if I can get it to pull up. So basically, this is going to increase your critical rate by 10% for 10 seconds when using it. And that's a really nice little added bonus to this finisher here. This finisher, when we take a look at the animations, we'll talk about, but is a very big part of his kit. It is an extremely good finisher card. So overall, really nice stuff. This character is great, just like you would expect for most any of your Boss Syndrome characters. But let's go ahead and take a look under the hood and talk about the actual skill animations. So leading it off with the basic string for the skills for Boss Syndrome Ignis, his string is actually going to be a little bit slow. It does lack any proper off the ground as a result, because the actual off the ground of it is so late into the string that you'll very rarely ever get to it before the character is already getting back up. But overall, not a big deal, just something to note. So with the S1, this is going to be a full screen fast moving projectile. It does not have off the ground at long range. You will actually have to get fairly close to the opponent in order to get the off the ground from this skill, but it does have it on the kit. It's just going to be something where you will have to be right on top of the opponent in order to be able to do that and continue your combo. And comboing is definitely no big deal with Ignis, because his chaining is comboing and his juggling is incredible. So next up on to the S2. The S2 is probably, like I've already mentioned, going to be his best skill. steel. This is going to be your source of hyper armor. It has extremely long range. It's kind of in the middle of the road as far as its speed is concerned for its animation, but being the fact that it can connect from full screen and does have off the ground, it's a very reliable overall skill for him and one of his best, if not the best. Next up on the S3, this is going to be your teleporting grab. This one's a little bit wonky, but it's really good. It has off the ground, it has really good speed, has really good range. However, keep in mind, this is not going to be a full screen grab because you actually will fail the skill if you are full screen away from the opponent. So make sure you keep that in mind. Now, moving on to the finishers, which is really where this character starts to shine. You're going to have the card finisher here. This is going to be a 9-second long animation, which is very, very long, and it does have the ability to interrupt skill animations and stop opposing bosses with it, like a lot of these cinematic finishers do, which is always really nice. And then on the core finisher here, this is going to be on the shorter end, but it is really handy for a lot of things, particularly with Guild Raid Geese, and we'll talk more about that when we get to Guild Raid. But that is your skills overall. Very, very good stuff. This character has a great kit in general, and I'm pretty happy with it overall. But moving on to mobbing, as I'm sure you can imagine based on what you just saw with the skill animations, you're going to have fantastic XY axis on this character, meaning he is going to be able to go in against these random mobs and just be able to clear them outright. There's really not a whole lot of thinking that you need to do with this character in this regard. You can kind of just take him in, and he's going to be able to get the job done. To me, the jury is still out on how he's going to be in time attack, although I would assume he is going to be phenomenal for it. I don't see any reason why he probably wouldn't be. He interrupts his skills very, very easily. He's going to have that very long 3PG finisher, and he's able to one-tap these mobs, so I don't see any reason why he wouldn't be. Now, if we take a look at regular bosses, any generic bosses for this character, he's going to be able to take down fairly easily. The only thing about this character is he does lack the damage that you see on some of these kind of higher damage boss syndrome characters. However, it really doesn't make a huge difference, and you're really kind of splitting hairs with him whenever you talk about that, because with him, he's still going to be able to do respectable damage overall, and probably the best showcase of that is going to be on the final stage here for this elemental boss. As you can see from this footage, he is able to start and finish this boss fight. So the damage, a lot of people talk about him having low damage, and I think that that's if you're comparing him to characters such as SS Kyo and some of the highest damage dealers in the entire game, then of course he is going to have low damage. And yes, he is going to have lower damage than a lot of the boss syndrome characters. But as a blue balance type, you come to expect that, and really the trade-off there is that this character is going to be a little bit less squishy than what you would see with some of those characters. So I don't think it's necessarily to his detriment in any way, shape, or form. I really think that with this character, his biggest thing is going to be the fact that he is going to be able to cheese off so many skills because of his core effects that you can kind of just forgive anything with that. And really, when it comes to being able to do that with those skills, it gets ridiculous. It almost gets to the point where you wonder if you could play this character without cooldown reduction cards and see what other types of things and other types of builds you could do with him. I've thought about doing that myself, but really, at the end of the day, when it comes to general mobbing, general bossing, this character is going to be just as good as some of the best. There's really not a whole lot negative that you can say about him in that regard. Maybe with the fact that his animations on his skills can be a little bit on the slower end at times, that might leave him open to a little bit of hits here or there, but overall, I would say you're nitpicking at that point, and that this character is going to be one of the better options out there for PvE mobbing and bossing, in my opinion. Now, I'm sure you guys know exactly what I'm going to say as it concerns PvAI, but PvAI is what? it's a meme. So therefore, this character is going to be able to go in and just cheese through this thing. When it comes to PvAI, there's really not a whole lot to be said about it, and there's really not a whole lot of effort that goes into it, to be honest with you guys. I would say that really he's going to perform just as well, if not better, than your best characters out there. Really the biggest thing with him is, again, he does kind of have a little bit of a slower end animation startup on some of his animations, so every once in a while, maybe he'll leave himself open, but again, it's just a bit of a nitpick, and really he's just going to bully anything that he goes up against in this mode, so don't worry about it too much. Now, of course, one of the most important parts of Ignis' game is going to be in Guild Raid, particularly against Nightmare Geese, and I'm happy to say that he not only does a respectable job against Lunatic difficulty here, but he is absolutely ridiculous against Lunatic difficulty here. So, the nice thing about this character is he's going to have several different ways of countering Guild Raid Geese. The first one is going to be his core that gives him Darkness Immunity, being that that grants him that immunity, he's going to be able to largely ignore the ground aura if Geese is able to get it off. However, the other part of his kit that makes him absolutely bonkers against Geese is going to be the fact that he can interrupt his Raging Storm ground aura version with not only his 3PG card finisher, but also his core finisher, which actually ends up being the better route in my opinion, because it is a fast animation and does really good shield shred. So if you have shock applied to Geese when he goes for that Raging Storm, as you see right here, you can go ahead and just drop that shield, and even if you don't drop the shield with it, by the time your animation finishes, he's just going to go back into doing whatever it is he's doing, and you will not have to contend with that ground stagger. So overall, as you can see from this footage, and as I'm sure you guys have seen from my solos with this character in this mode, you are going to be able to achieve, just as a pure solo, using nothing but Ignis as the leader and whatever striker you're using with him, you're going to be able to 2-key Lunatic at Awakening level 3 or higher, so it's not going to be anything that's overly difficult. Really, you just need to make sure that you are sprinkling in as many of your basic attacks as possible, so that that way you can get off as many of your skills as possible. And this is really where that core, where he's able to reduce his own cooldowns, comes into play in a big way. This in Immortals is going to be where you see that be very, very useful. And just this character in general, had those cores been on a high damaging attack type nuke, everybody would be freaking out. I feel like this character deserves a lot more love than he has gotten, and I feel like Zero, for whatever reason, has kind of overshadowed him in a lot of players' minds. Maybe it's the fact that Zero looks like he's something out of a Dragon Ball Z OVA, I don't really know, but I will say that with Ignis in Guild Raid, this character is an absolute dream, and with that, it all comes down to the cores. The cores are what makes this character. You could really have just, if you strip those cores away, then this character would be kind of a middle of the road, just kind of really decent boss syndrome character, but as it sits, having the ability to lower his own cooldowns in such an easy, reliable way, having the ability to have that amazing power charge on this kit, all the things that come with this character under the hood with those cores makes him an extremely powerful option, and probably the best overall option available currently in the game for Nightmare Geese, at least specifically as it relates to the Lunatic difficulty. And I would say that if you find yourself needing help against this character, you're definitely going to want to take a look at Boss Syndrome Ignis. Now, once we get to Immortals, there's really not a whole lot to say here outside of the fact that Ignis is going to be a phenomenal option. So Ignis is going to make a very, very good leader for Immortals because of the fact that he's able to cover so much ground with the all-star tags that he is buffing. It's going to be able to buff your special signature fighters, your boss syndrome fighters, and your collaboration fighters, as we have already discussed, among other characters, but really the biggest ones are going to be your boss syndrome and your special signature fighters. So if you take him into Immortals, there's a couple of things you're going to need to know. The first thing is going to be that he is going to do a really good job of not taking damage. Ignis in general, because he is able to fire off his skills so often and pretty much never have his skills on a full cooldown, basically with the S2, you're just going to want to spam that and keep his hyper armor going. And if you do that, then you're really not going to have to worry about a whole lot like you would with some of these attack types that don't have as reliable ways to protect themselves. So what you're going to notice is you don't have to babysit him as much, and you can almost let him just do his thing. The other part about him that makes him really, really good here is of course going to be that card finisher being so long. That 9-second animation is going to make all the difference in the world. And really overall with this character, he is going to basically allow for you to do some pretty ridiculous things with team comps, because you're able to mix and match all of these different special characters like your SS characters, your BS characters, and your collaboration characters, and kind of put them under the same umbrella, which is going to of course be Ignis here. So this character in general, in my opinion, in PvE and in Immortals, is going to be one of the stronger Boss Syndrome characters we've seen in a long time. I don't necessarily think that he is anything that is a must-have at this point, but I do think that he complements so many of these other characters so well, particularly because of the fact that he does have that leadership ability, that I would say that you're going to want to take a pretty hard look at him if you have a large amount of these limited banner characters in general. So overall, I think that this character, while he isn't a must-have, basically if you find yourself in a position where you have a ton of limited banner characters, whether they be the SS or the BS characters, or even your collaboration characters to a lesser extent, then you're basically going to look at this character in a different light than someone who doesn't have a lot of those characters, because if you do have a bunch of them, then you're going to find just that much more use because of this leadership ability here, making him a phenomenal option for Immortals, and one that you'll probably use a lot going forward. But really, his biggest claim to fame in PvE is going to be against Guild Raid Nightmare Geese on Lunatic difficulty. That is going to be his bread and butter, and likely the place where you are going to be identifying him as a big get. But outside of that, this character in general is really good. There's not a whole lot you can say negatively about him. Would you like to see a little bit more damage? Well, yeah, but at the same time, being that he's a balanced type, it ends up evening out. But overall, I'm extremely happy with him. I will say one thing, though, and this is just something I want to say as an aside. Netmarble, be very careful with what you do with this effect going forward. If you start adding it to characters left and right, we're going to start looking at that as being a prerequisite on these characters as to whether or not they end up being good or not in our eyes, because just like with the 30% power charge rate being one of the things people instantly look for with these limited banner characters, if you start using this cooldown reduction on your basic skills for a lot of different characters, it's going to end up getting nutty, and it's going to be a little bit ridiculous and a little too much, at least in my opinion. But that is my opinions on Boss Syndrome Ignis. You guys let me know yours in the comment section down below. I will be back tomorrow with another spotlight video, but until then, you guys stay cool, enjoy the rest of your days, like, share, and subscribe. I'll see you in the next one. Peace.